Good morning, everyone. Welcome to day two of the American Geophysical Union's second annual policy conference. For those of you I didn't get a chance to meet yesterday, I'm Chris McEntee, and I'm the executive director of the American Geophysical Union. Yesterday, we heard talks about how public policy can help us reduce our risks from natural disasters and hazards, what's on the horizon for new energy technologies, and the challenges we face as a country from the water-energy nexus. We also heard a plenary on the value of science that featured the acting director of the National Science Foundation, Dr. Cora Merritt, and former chair of the House Committee on Science and Technology, Representative Bart Gordon. In addition to this morning's plenary on climate change, today we will hear about the future of science in space, the science, policy, and communications challenges associated with sea level rise, and the effect climate change is having on agriculture and human health. Yesterday, President Obama unveiled his new plan for addressing climate change. He spoke about preparing for its effect and reducing carbon emissions, as well as the need for a global approach to solutions. As we move through today's presentations, I look forward to hearing your reactions to his plan and to discussing the challenges and opportunities it represents. And if you didn't get a chance to hear it, I will let you know he did stress many times throughout the speech the value of science and allowing us to first understand what climate change is about, the impacts it's having, and how it's going to be needed to be able to do mitigation and adaptation for the future. I hope you'll continue your discussions this afternoon as we conclude the conference with a poster presentation and networking event from 3 to 5 p.m. in Poster Hall Rooms 146 B and C. You can enjoy refreshments. Wouldn't be an AGU meeting if we didn't have refreshments at the breaks. And conversation with your fellow participants. Make new connections and maybe even foster some new scientific, policy, and communications collaborations. Before we move into this morning's plenary, I just want you to remind you to keep your phones and tablets out, but silenced, and to use the conference hashtag AGUSPC to join in the conversation online. Also, as we did yesterday, we're going to have a live poll during this session. And for our online audience, the link to that online poll is in the right-hand corner. And for those of you who are here present, the URL is on the screen behind me. Please take a moment to participate. The results will be shared later during the session. I really think the discussion we are about to have on preparing for our future and climate change will help frame our sessions for the rest of the day by looking to the future and describing what changes we can expect in this warming world. I'm very pleased to introduce our plenary speakers who were both awarded AGU's 2013 Presidential Citation for Science and Society for their tremendous work advancing the public's understanding and appreciation of Earth and space science. Richard Harris is an award-winning journalist and correspondent for National Public Radio who has brought science into the homes of millions of people through his unbiased reporting. Throughout his career, he has covered all aspects of science and technology, from cell biology to planetary science, and his stories have included coverage of many public safety issues, including earthquakes and devastating tsunamis. And for decades, he has closely followed the evolving story of climate change. James Balog is a leader in photography and interpreting the national environment. He founded and directed the Extreme Ice Survey to document the impact of climate change through a photographic survey of glaciers. Many of you may have seen these surveys sitting in an airline waiting room as you were waiting for a flight. His work on the project is the subject of the award-winning documentary Chasing Ice. An avid mountaineer and an author of 8 books, Balog has a graduate degree in geography and geomorphology. He is passionate about combining art and science to examine the changes in the natural world and dedicated to communicating both verbally and visually the impacts of those changes to the public. Please join me in welcoming Richard Harris and James Balog. Welcome. I'm going to turn it over to Richard, who's going to share some remarks. He's also going to be the moderator for this session.
Thank you very much. It's a great pleasure to be here, and I will make some remarks that I hope will be relatively short, because James Balog has a presentation I'm eagerly awaiting to see that's audiovisual, or at least visual. And if you've ever seen his photographs, you will know why I'm eager to see more, because they're just spectacular. But I want to thank you very much for coming, and thank the AGU for the great honor of this award. And I just wanted to, if people were at the event last night, you sort of heard a few of my comments about this. In the grand tradition of Washington, D.C., congressmen always say that they reserve the right to amend and extend their remarks, and I think I will essentially do that right now for a few minutes and talk about sort of how I ended up here and give you some perspective on just how I think about science communication and how you can think about a little bit about how to affect the process that's going on here in Washington. And like many scientists, the spark for my career was just an interest, really fascination with science. My undergraduate degree is actually in biology, but I also love studying chemistry and physics and everything else that I wandered through. And I was just fascinated by the physical processes. And really, earth science I came across on the job. I did not take extensive classes in it at all in college, but in California, there's what we call in the business a teachable moment. There are always earthquakes, and as a journalist in California, that's obviously an opportunity to start reporting about earth sciences. And really, the AGU meetings in San Francisco, where I was based, were just a gold mine of wonderful stories. So every year I'd go and plumb the depths of the AGU meetings, and it was an education in and of itself. In fact, it was at the AGU meetings that I first, in those early days, in the early 1980s, that I first came across the issue of climate change. And some of the early presentations were curious to me because people were saying, okay, this is going to happen sometime in the next century. And there was no question that it was going to happen, but it was completely abstract, as though climate change were equivalent to, well, the sun's going to burn out in 4.5 billion years. It's like, okay, it's a fact, shrug, we're not going to do anything about it, but we're not questioning the reality of that. And in those early days, that's kind of how climate change started percolating up in the scientific community, I think. And I followed the topic as it gradually morphed over the intervening decades from really people grappling with understanding the science of what's going to happen, when, et cetera, obviously issues that are not fully resolved at this point, into the realm of policy. And I ended up chasing the story to Kyoto, where the climate talks were taking place, and on to Bali and Copenhagen. It's a good travel gig if you don't mind working 23 hours a day at those international meetings. So I found that really that, you know, that it was really an awakening to realize how international processes and, you know, the United Nations and so on deals. If you want to think about glacial speed of things, don't think in terms of earth science, think in terms of the United Nations. But at the same time, I was able to keep reporting on the story from the field where change was evident. Like James Balog, I love ice. I think maybe somebody should make a documentary about me called Chasing Balog, maybe, because I've been to many of the same places he's been to. I've been to Iceland, took a couple of trips to Greenland. I was up on the summit of Greenland when they were drilling the core down to the bottom of the ice, and basically to get the history of the ice on Greenland. I also spent some time out on the flat part where it was melting on the surface and the water was pooling up on the surface and rushing down into moulins and so on. And that was a fascinating trip that I took out there. I also managed to get to the Arctic Ocean following biologists who were trying to understand how that ecosystem is changing as the ice dynamics are changing so dramatically. Antarctica as well. And for a tropical change of pace, I also, just earlier this year, was on the Great Barrier Reef doing stories about ocean acidification. I will say, this being Washington, this is an important element as well. The story has drawn me into another perplexing realm, and that is the realm of human behavior. why is it that some people are so eager to convince themselves that this isn't happening, you know, or that all the signs that I've witnessed over the decades is some massive fraud being perpetrated on the public? Why do people come up with that point of view? And what does it take to get ordinary citizens and politicians to recognize the consequences if it turns out that they're wrong and the vast majority of science is right about what's going on with climate change? And back in 1984, I decided to talk to a few key people in the world of climate science, and one of them was the grand old men of earth science, Wally Broker, up at Lamont Doherty. And I asked him how he dealt with people who deny that climate change is real and happening. And here's what he said, I'm going to quote. He said, "It's really sad that people are willing to take that strong a stand about something that's so important." He went on to say, "I'm willing to admit that it could be trivial, but they're not willing to admit it could be serious. That's the difference. We're playing with our whole planet, and we're, damn it, just to get energy for a couple hundred years, or 100 years, he said. So, you know, there is uncertainty in science, and the question is, how do you cope with that uncertainty? Do you use it as an excuse to ignore everything, or do you say, look, how, you know, if it as bad as it could be, can we really afford to take the long shot bet that it's not going to be bad? And as you well know, dozens of members of Congress dispute that climate change is even an issue. Yesterday, President Obama referred to them as the Flat Earth Society. And you may be wondering, if you're from out of town, a scientist coming into Washington, what you can do to change that dynamic. And I say, well, good luck. I would just point out, of course, if these elected officials were really willing to ignore the rather forceful findings of the National Academy of Sciences and some of the very strong statements coming out from the AGU and other professional organizations, they're probably not going to be moved that much by an individual scientist trying to reason with them. They will be moved, though, by two things. First of all, if their thought leaders change their minds, so will they, I think. So if Newt Gingrich and John McCain, who used to be advocates for doing something about climate change and acknowledge the difficulties that we face looking ahead, if they go back to their former positions on this issue, I think that would bring a lot of Republicans with them. Not all, for sure, but some. But what this really hinges on, though, is I think an argument that's not about science, but about convincing people that doing something about climate change will be a boon for their districts, that it will fit into their, not only help them economically, but fit into their philosophy. And in his speech yesterday, President Obama noted that 75% of wind energy is in Republican states. So that's a start. He actually got some support for wind from some of the Republicans because they had a vested interest in it. But wind is not competing anywhere close with fossil fuels and other powerful economic interests right now. So what's more likely to make a difference, I think, is watching what will happen in states like California that have very ambitious plans. And if it turns out that California's renewable fuel standard turns out to be successful and an economic boon, I think other states will go, okay, this isn't going to hurt so much. Maybe it's new jobs and it'll help us. And they'll follow California's lead. So I think it's pretty evident that leadership in this issue is coming from the states first, and the federal government will perhaps reluctantly follow, and will maybe cheerfully follow if states come up with things that turn out to be actually quite positive and helpful for the state. So that's just a little something to think about, and we can talk about that more in the question and answer period. I will note, though, that this leaves me as a communicator in somewhat of an odd spot, because on the one hand, I figured that no new factual information I can put out there about climate change is really going to fundamentally change the dynamic here in Washington, because it's not really about science. But on the other hand, I can't just throw up my hands and say, well, forget it, I'm not going to report about this anymore. I think it's important to keep putting that message out there for people who are open to thinking about this. I'm also aware that it's easy to get people overwhelmed with the facts, too, and I think about this as well. I produced some pretty grim stories from my trip in Australia about ocean acidification that looks pretty bad for the coral reefs in the not very distant future. And those stories went on the radio, and people who were cooking dinner or driving their cars or whatever clearly heard those stories. But I also made versions of those for the web. And I must say, people were not flocking to the web stories to read about this news. It's too depressing. People turn their back. They don't want to think about the worst, you know, that could happen to this planet, even things that are likely to happen. It's a downer. People are not interested in that. So that leaves me with a little bit of a conundrum. I clearly don't want to bury the truth, and I don't want to sugarcoat it. But I also recognize that I have to think about ways to appeal to people. And so one thing I do is I also turn to stories that are hopeful stories about people who are developing new technologies and people who are thinking about ways to solve these problems. Because it's not a hopeless problem. It's just a politically difficult problem. I mean, technically, it's not hopeless at all. So I do take care not to overstate what we know. I think the facts as we know them are compelling enough. So that's really, I think it can be counterproductive to spice things up more than they need to be. They don't need to be spiced up. Just straight ahead is scary enough. So anyway, as you know, like science, figuring out how to communicate it is also is forever a work in progress. Unfortunately, the clock is ticking, so we can't just simply sit on our ideas as Charles Darwin did. What he waited about 20 years after he came up with the theory of evolution before he got around to publishing it after he heard a lot of hoofbeats behind him. So we don't have that kind of luxury to sit and cogitate and wait for things to change. And I think President Obama made that case fairly persuasively yesterday during his speech. And I guess I will end on the thought that as a journalist, I'm not supposed to be an advocate. I'm not an advocate, but I do advocate one thing. I believe that people should know the facts, and I do my best to deliver them as clearly and as honestly as I can. And so people can make rational decisions. I think that's what we need as a society, good facts so we can make rational decisions when we're ready to make those rational decisions, because we know. But we know what's at stake. So anyway, a few thoughts for further mulling. At this point, I would like to turn the podium over to James Balog and his presentation, which I will sit in the audience to watch. Thank you very much.
Thank you. See you in a bit. Thank you, Richard, and thanks to all of you for being here. I'm going to take you through my own personal journey through these issues right now, and I come to you with a perspective based on a combination of art and science. I've come to realize that these are two different language structures, two different ways of thinking, two different ways of processing the world in integrating these various polarities, in integrating these various polarities, these two polarities, I think we come to a richer understanding of what's actually going on. For the lay public particularly, just showing graphs and numbers and statistics doesn't get us anywhere. And so through the language of the arts combined with the scientific context, I think we've demonstrably achieved a much greater impact on the public thinking about climate change than we had before. So this whole show will be about the integration of art and science. And of course it will be based in this big word. And I'm going to take a poll right now because I'm not even sure what the answer to this is. How do we pronounce this word? Is it Anthropocene or is it Anthropocene? I want a show of hands. Anthropocene? Anthropocene. Okay, so it shall be. Anthropocene. Okay, Anthropocene. Anybody else? Anthropocene. Okay, that's what I was using for years, and then I started to hear this other term. So, okay, Anthropocene. Good. We'll go with that. Anyway, we're a curious creature. We're connected with the natural world. We understand that. And we are supported by the natural world. And these little images of our nearest genetic relative, the chimpanzee, in connection with various people, is in a way my expression of that relationship. But we have caused many animals to go extinct in the world, and it's because of a lack of proper natural habitat to live in. So this little body of work from survivors, something I did back in the late 1980s, is something of an expression of that. Here is some of the surviving members of their species. No normal place to live, seen in a studio environment. So one of the issues that's connected with this era of anthropogenic change is destruction of habitat and animals not having proper places to live. And you see behaviors connected with us, reflected in a mandrill. I see at least 10 people sitting out in the room in a position a lot like this. And walking around here before I found myself falling into this posture. Anyway, we're connected to these guys. We're connected to the natural world. And we have these immense powers, though, these technological powers. And our impact on the natural world is a combination of our technological power multiplied by our desire for affluence, multiplied by our human populations. All of that together, population times affluence times technology equals impact. And in this case, we're looking at a guy who works in the hazardous materials cleanup business. And so we have to protect ourselves from our technology. This is a key part of any story about anthropogenic change today. Our great technological powers give us unbelievable capability. This is a guy who was an electric company lineman down in Oklahoma who lost his limbs in an electrocution accident, but now through technology, this is already 15 years ago, this is ancient technology, he gets the chance to feel the world again through his fingertips. I stand here today, 7 weeks after a knee replacement operation, and I thank my lucky stars that I have that opportunity. I've got titanium and cobalt in my leg. Otherwise, I'd be a cripple like a farmer would have been who, after he had gotten kicked by a cow 100 years ago or 200 years ago, I'd be crippled and hobbling around. So the technology gives us these incredible powers, incredible extension of life and opportunity. But unfortunately, a good bit of our current age, obviously, depends on this substance called hydrocarbons. And what I think about over and over again, having been down at the Gulf oil spill, which is where this picture was shot, is that we're dependent on the toxic refuse of ancient biologic life that was deposited underground by the forces of geology. And now here we are digging up this toxic substance and reusing it and causing trouble in our world. I find that extraordinarily troubling. And baffling, really, that we do that. Again, toxic refuse, toxic waste from biologic processes, and now it re-enters our world. In the course of introducing this toxic waste back into our lives, we cause all kinds of problems. And that's what a lot of the rest of this show will be about. What do these things look like in the real world? I live in Colorado in the foothills of the Rockies, and you cannot believe what it's like to have wildfires all around you all summer long. And now summer starts, in terms of wildfires, it starts in January and it ends in December. They go all year long now. There's no summer fire season anymore. This is the fire last year down by Colorado Springs that at that time was the record-breaking fire in our state. Now, there was a new record-breaking fire 2 weeks ago, the Black Forest fire. But it's extraordinary when these events are in your own backyard. Makes you think about the world differently. This was a fire in my own real-life backyard. The perimeter of the fire ended about 3/4 of a mile away as the crow flies from my house. And it was on Labor Day morning a few years ago. And this is what it looked like. This is a slurry bomber that was coming by. This is probably what saved our house, was that retardant drop. And this is what we looked at from the deck of my house. The statistics on the wildfires are clear. They're bigger, they last longer. And there's more of them, lots more. This is not a hypothetical. This is real. This is measured by people who, you know, are fire specialists. This, of course, is a consequence of drought. If you've been in the West for any period of time, you realize how much drier things are than they used to be. It's kind of staggering. We fortunately, in the Front Range, just had a pretty good late season snowfall in April. I mean, actually extraordinary, record-breaking. And in spite of that, we've got fires all over the place right now because of how hot and dry it's been. This is what it looks like after the fires go through. This is one of my neighbors and what's left of their house. And you can look down in the bottom of the picture, and there's a little silver stripe of stuff coming over those stairs. And that would be this material, which is aluminum from lawn chairs that melted in the fire. What's left of a motorcycle? In the forest, of course, the trees don't actually burn. People think that the trees just burn to ashes. They don't. The fires come blazing through these gigantic firestorms. It sears off all the pine needles, chars all the bark, and you lose hundreds of thousands of trees. But the trees are still standing, these skeletal relics of what was once there. Now, speaking of relics, the other thing that happens in our world is deforestation. And the human race has built an enormous part of its prosperity on the deforestation of primeval forests, particularly here in the United States. A lot of our prosperity back in the 19th century and the 18th century and the 17th century was based on deforestation, starting on the Atlantic coast and going all the way west as far as there were ancient forests. And this was something I never realized until the late 90s when I started doing a six-year-long project on America's largest, oldest trees. And places like Michigan that are now pastoral farmland were covered with hardwood and pine forests. Thick, big trees, all gone. So this is part of our anthropogenic impact on the world as well. And I'm endlessly fascinated by some of these great botanical characters. And I did a series of portraits of America's largest, oldest trees. This is a shot of one of the largest living organisms in the world, the giant sequoia in California, named Stag. And we're seeing it in 450 frames rappelling down through the forest. One of my tree riggers is up there on the top. A guy named Billy Ellison, and I'm rappelling down through the forest, shooting it in sections as I go. It's too big to see it in one view. So we shoot it in the sections and come back and look at the tree as an individual character. And this, too, is a survivor of the pre-Columbian forest. This tree's a couple thousand years old, at least. Nobody really knows for sure. The base is 28 feet in diameter, which would make it about from the middle of the stage to the wall. It's a big tree, big organism. It's really, really impressive when you walk around the base of these things, and a lot of the old guys are gone. 95% have been cut down already. Another impact on the forest of today comes from little bug, tiny little bug. This shot is of a white bark pine in Wyoming. And these are old trees as well, not as old as the sequoias and the redwoods, but still in a 1,000-year-old plus category. And they are no match for a little bug that's the size of a grain of rice called the mountain pine beetle. There's actually about a dozen different subspecies of this character. But these things have been unleashed by climate change. And we have a massive insect blight still going on. It died down a couple years ago to some extent, but it's back out in force a lot this past year. I was just down in southwestern Colorado near Telluride, and I was amazed at all the fresh infestation in that part of the world. But huge impact across broad parts of the West, and it goes all the way up into Alaska as well. It's usually talked about as a Rocky Mountain or British Columbia phenomenon, but it's all over the place. This is what it looks like. This is in the Gros Ventre Range outside Jackson, Wyoming. And we like to see the Rocky Mountain landscape in this romantic fashion with pretty mule's ear flowers in the foreground. But if you shift your focus, that's what you've got, all of those gray trees, every single white bark pine in that landscape is dead. The only green trees left are spruce and fir that are resistant to the beetle and or are not tasty or whatever it is. So it's a widespread phenomenon. Here's what it looks like in Rocky Mountain National Park over the course of 5 months. This is a stand of lodgepole pine seen in time lapse. The beetles drill in through the bark, and they shut off the passage of moisture from the roots up to the needles, and the trees simply die. Now we turn time backwards here so you can remember what once was. So we're going backwards. Trees coming back alive. Without the camera memory, you would barely remember where this thing started. So that's where it started. And now we go forward quickly again. And they're gone. Rocky Mountain National Park is getting ravaged by these bugs. And we're losing a part of the national heritage. Now this project that many of you know, the Extreme Ice Survey, it grew out of a story I did for The New Yorker in 2005 and then National Geographic. Photographed it in 2006, published in 2007. And it's motivated by the fact that glaciers are basically what I think of as a barometer. There is no such thing as a barometer. That's a word that I invented because Susan Hassel said we should invent words to help describe these things. But it's a combination of a barometer. Glaciers are a combination of a barometer and a thermometer. Air pressure on the one hand that brings moisture to a region, and on the other hand, temperature. Glaciers form when more snow falls in the winter than melts away in the summer. And it's primarily a question of changes in summer temperature that governs the behavior of glaciers. So when you see ice disappearing, it's speaking volumes about regional climate and the warming of the regional climate in the summertime. So around the vast majority of the world, outside Antarctica, glaciers are retreating. There's a few exceptions to that, particularly in the Karakoram in Pakistan. But for the most part, glaciers are retreating. And even in Pakistan, they're barely advancing. Everything in South America, North America, Europe, Asia, Africa is retreating. And so we did this project called the Extreme Ice Survey because of what I saw when I was out there in the world. And what we did was deploy time-lapse cameras, fix them to bedrock alongside these glaciers, told the cameras to fire every hour or half hour around the clock as long as it was daylight, and tell us what it looks like as the world is changing. One of the things we discovered is that old phrase, glacial pace, is an oxymoron. There is no such thing as glacial pace. The idea that we had all had about glaciers for basically forever was that they were big, lumpen, slow-moving objects. And what we discovered in the course of looking at them with these cameras is that they react on an hourly or daily basis, certainly a weekly and monthly basis, to the climate around them. So we built these cameras. They're Nikon cameras powered by solar panels that are in the bottom left. We take these little pelican housings, cut windows in them, put plexiglass covers on those windows, and we bolt them to bedrock and see what happens. Anybody know where we are here? What's that mountain in the top left? Taking a quiz. Scientists, you need to get out on the ground more. This is Mount Everest, top left, and the Khumbu Glacier coming down from the middle left and circling around us here. And this next frame will show us a view from this camera mounted on the cliff into the Khumbu Icefall, which is in the center of the left side of the frame. So we're going to see what the Khumbu looks like, what a moving glacier looks like over the course of a couple of years. So it's a giant river of ice taking this mass of ice and snow from the upper reaches of Everest down into the valley. And the climbing route basically starts down on the bottom left side of this creature, goes up the middle, and then banks right. It's an ugly place to climb. Lots of people get killed in there. There's all sorts of tragedies and commotion, and you can see why. These are blocks of ice many times the size of this room collapsing on a daily basis. That's a glacier. Our project is in a whole bunch of different locations around the world. We have always wanted to be in the Southern Hemisphere, and up until this year didn't have the fiscal and human capacity to be down there, but we're in the process of deploying 10 cameras in Patagonia next winter and 10 others in Antarctica. We have one in Antarctica right now, but we'll do a lot more next year. It's a big project, huge team working on this, and there's, for everybody who's in this frame, we could show many more who also contribute their efforts, but you'll notice my wife in the top right corner and my kids across the bottom row, and I include them as part of the team because they provide so much logistical support and their lives have been completely overrun by Dad's project, which usually they enjoy and not, but not always. So let's show you a little clip from Chasing Ice, the film. Now to frame the story of Chasing Ice, we didn't set out to make a film. How many of you have seen the film, either live in the theaters or on TV or whatever? Okay, good. The film grew out of the Extreme Ice Survey. It, again, we were not intending to be filmmakers in this project. And it came about because we knew there was some kind of a story there, and we wanted to record it in video. And eventually, one of our team members, Jeff Orlowski, broke away, became his own film production company after a lot of the film had been shot. And he pulled in some film editors and pulled in Skywalker Sound and some other folks to help him create this film, and it became Chasing Ice, which released a year and a half ago at Sundance to great acclaim and winning awards, and it's traveled the world now in film festivals. If you're interested in seeing it, I want to mention all this right now because I often forget it. If you're interested in seeing it, it's being broadcast and rebroadcast on the National Geographic Channel. It's being shown in 171 countries right now. It's in rotation for the next 5 years. It premiered in April. It's also right now available on Netflix and iTunes, and DVDs will be out in early September. So this clip gives you a little taste of what's in the film. It's a combination of the science story of climate and glaciers and the human drama. And basically, as they constructed the film, they decided to use the human drama, the personal drama, as a way to tell the story of the ice and climate, to travel those two roads together.
I'm on the phone with Jim on one of our regular check-ins. Like, Jim, nothing's happening.
It's starting, Adam. I think, Adam, it's starting, right?
Look at that. Look at the whole thing.
It all started in Iceland.
I think I'm so certain to get wet, I'll take my boots off.
I never imagined that you could see glaciers this big disappearing in such a short time. There's a powerful piece of history that's unfolding in these pictures, and I have to go back. The initial goal was to put out 25 cameras for 3 years, shoot every hour as long as it was daylight, that would show you how the landscape was changing.
Oh, this is the way to travel, my friend.
Putting really delicate electronics in the harshest conditions on the planet.
It's not the nicest environment for technology.
I do not want to go any lower than this. It's just bottomless.
I'm going out here on this broken fin, and I assume it won't collapse.
Every once in a while, you get sane. What were you thinking? Maybe that office job wasn't so bad.
This thing is loose.
Rock!
It's not working.
God!
All of that obsession means nothing if it doesn't work.
Just be careful. Don't get too close to the edge, all right?
This is terrifying.
His knee has had two surgeries, and it really could use a third.
He goes to that point where he can't anymore, and sometimes he's going further.
We have low oil pressure, engine number two.
This is big stuff happening right now.
Okay, onward.
This is the memory of the landscape. That landscape is gone. It may never be seen again in the history of civilization, and it's stored right here. For the most part, the theatrical run in the United States is finished with. It is touring in Europe and Asia right now. It's in a few cities in the United States, but mostly you have to see it on TV or these other channels, as I said. So, here's what we've seen. A few select samples from the extreme ice survey. Right now, we're in Bolivia, in South America, up in the Andes, just to kind of get us started. A glacier used to occupy that entire mountainside within the perimeter of that yellow line. It was called the Chacaltaya Glacier. When I got there in August of 2006, the glacier had shrunk into that wretched little scrap of snow outlined by the red line. And this used to be the site of the world's highest ski area, tallest ski area. Top of that mountain is nearly 18,000 feet. And 2 years later, that glacier had shrunken to this little piece. And by 2009, it was completely gone. This is happening up and down the length of the Andes from Ecuador all the way down to Tierra del Fuego. Tremendous deglaciation going on as climate change basically scrapes away like a bulldozer at the surface of those glaciers, losing mass balance continuously. This is up at that site where I was holding the flashcard in the film clip. This is the Mendenhall Glacier in southeast Alaska. 6 year time lapse. This is history unspooling right in front of your eyes. If you didn't have the camera memory, you would have nothing imprinted in your head about where this thing started, what used to be. It's only through the photographic memory that we preserve any real record of what was. Check that out. That's where it was, and this is where it's gone to as of this past March. Columbia Glacier, south central Alaska, the next big fjord to the west of Valdez, where the Trans-Alaska Pipeline comes down from Prudhoe Bay. Here's what we saw. We started to realize the thing was retreating way faster than we thought. We pivoted the camera, and now we watch it flowing and retreating at the same time. That wall of ice, where it breaks off into the ocean, is called a calving face. That's where these big dramatic towers of ice splash into the water. You see that in nature films all the time. We'll see more about that on a different glacier in a second. So we turn time backwards again, put Humpty Dumpty back together. That's what was, and that's what's become. That glacier is probably going to retreat at least a couple more miles up the left side of that frame, and you'll see over on the right side, there's a little island that's in the process of emerging from under the ice. We just got our pictures back from Greenland 2 days ago, and if anybody work at the Ilulissat Glacier outside Jakobshavn? No, okay. Anyway, it looks like there's a big mountain that's in the process of appearing from underneath the Greenland ice sheet. Stay tuned. I think in a couple years we'll be seeing that come out of the ice. But that's a whole other story. So, speaking of Greenland, the entire Arctic Ocean basin has warmed a lot. You've heard of Arctic amplification. As you peel the Arctic Ocean sea ice off the surface of the Arctic Ocean, the whole region gets warmer because of feedback loops, and this is what's been happening. Great warming down the west side of the ice sheet. The polar bears have fewer places to live. They're somewhat stressed. But the real story is what's happening as a consequence of the interaction of the oceans and the ice sheet. Huge increase in the ice loss. We've got cameras in a lot of different places, hard to get to in many cases, but we do the best we can. One thing before I show you the time lapse from Greenland. This was something that kind of popped out of the haze by surprise in 2009. We were seeing these big patches of black gunk deposited all over the ice. And I had been seeing it for several years, but I finally started to really think about it. Well, it turns out to be a combination of regional glacial outwash, silt and sediment that gets blown in, combined with coal-fired power plant emissions, soot from wood burning, diesel exhaust, that sort of thing, blowing around the world, falls out on the ice sheet, gets washed around in all the meltwater up on the surface of the ice, concentrated in these pools, and the black absorbs the heat and blowtorches its way down into the ice. It's called cryokinite, this black stuff. If you look at what's going on in the atmosphere via a NASA satellite, here you go. That's where the soot was coming from during the fall of 2009. And we are having it fall out over us all the time, even at these latitudes. We don't see it. It might be the grit you see on your car some mornings, conceivably, but generally you don't see it. The ice sheet sees it, collects it, and concentrates it. If you had taken a different snapshot of the year, particularly if you had done this kind of an animation in the wintertime, you would have seen a lot more soot coming out of the Northern Hemisphere, especially Scandinavia, Canada, in the United States from wood-burning stoves. So up real, real close, this patch of cryokinite's only about 6 inches in diameter, stuff blowtorches down an ancient fossilized air, in this case about 15,000 years old, is being released from the ice sheet. Those bubbles are ancient air. I never thought of air being anything like that. All of a sudden, the photography is saying to me, my God, there's such a thing as fossil air. There it is. So up to Greenland's largest emitter of ice, the Ilulissat Glacier, west central Greenland, helicopters seen for scale, rapidly diminishing scale, against the calving face. And now we turn on the time lapse. And this is the heart of Greenland pouring out into the ocean. This glacier runs approximately 125 feet a day, 40 plus meters a day, and it discharges more ice into the global ocean than anything else in the Northern Hemisphere. The iceberg that sank the Titanic is believed to have come from this fjord. It's been in rapid retreat. We actually have the ice front almost outside the field of view of this camera, and we're in the process of placing the cameras further up the fjord because the glacier is going to go marching back up into the interior. You can start to think about sea level rise as being the manifestation of the melting of these icebergs going out to sea. I mean, this is a real world event. This is a physical process that's tying all of these places together. Here's the biggest calving event, breakoff event, that's ever been recorded in the history of photography and filmmaking. And here we go. My team saw it because they were camped out there for 3 weeks. And the some of these bergs above sea level are as much as 600 feet high as they come shooting out of the ocean. On average, they're about 30 stories tall. And they're 10 times that underneath the water surface. This all happened over the course of 75 minutes, one May afternoon. That berg that just popped up is nearly the height of El Capitan in Yosemite, the huge cliff at the entrance of Yosemite Valley. There's another El Cap right there. It's really, 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 really hard to grasp, to get your head around the scale of this thing. You know, I've camped out there a lot, and I myself, I look at those pictures and I say, oh, I don't know what I'm looking at. So we have to resort to cheesy illustrations to give you a sense of scale. Here's the numbers of how big that block was that broke off in an hour and a quarter. But here are some comparisons that maybe mean a little bit more. And here in Washington, the story they love over on Capitol Hill is how many Capitol buildings would it take to fill up that block? And the answer is 3,000. That's a big chunk of ice, and that's a big Capitol building. So it's big things are happening right in front of our noses. This is all real. And essentially, the story is that nature isn't natural anymore. You know, forget all the fancy science language about eras of geologic time and so forth and so on. This is about nature isn't natural anymore, and it's not natural due to human impact. Now, even after showing some of these shows, every once in a while, not usually, but once in a while, somebody will wave their hands out in the audience and say, well, you know, I live in Florida. Why do I care about your Rocky Mountain wildfires? Well, here's the answer. Climate change matters if you breathe air, eat food, drink water, or pay taxes. And I'm not sure anybody has managed to escape any of those conditions. So all of these things are tied in with climate change. It's part of our lives. It's a universal issue. It doesn't belong to Republicans or Democrats. It's a universal issue about human health, safety, and security. Ask the people in New York City after Hurricane Sandy last year. We know we can't attribute Sandy specifically to climate change, but we're starting to get a fairly clear sense that there's a pattern of extreme events, precipitation events, wind events, et cetera, unfolding in our world, and probably that overall pattern is connected with climate change. The Midwest. Drought in the Midwest. Extremes get more extreme. You guys understand that. And this leads to a couple of big final conceptual points. The human race has always danced around on the surface of the Earth, assuming, without thinking about it, that we can't change the basic operating condition of the Earth, the basic biology, the basic chemistry, the basic physics. We've thought that the Earth was this big immutable platform, basically a stage like this one, where we could tap dance around and, yeah, okay, we'd cut down some trees, okay, yeah, we'll make a passenger pigeon or two go extinct, but so what? The basic systems won't be altered. That idea is going into the dustbin of history. Every era of civilization has its own assumptions that in hindsight seem absolutely ridiculous. You look back in history and you go, huh? How could people possibly have thought what they thought? Here's a couple of examples. This is what societies in the past 150 years in the United States took to be immutable truth, that slavery was necessary, child labor acceptable, and that women shouldn't be allowed to vote. 622,000 people were killed in the United States between 1861 and 1865 over the first point. In the time of my grandmother, 10-year-old kids were working in coal mines and textile mills. Okay, these are real things that we believe. Here's another one that's, as I say, in the process of disappearing into the realm of discredited truths that belonged to a past time. And we're in the midst of a gigantic intellectual revolution. That's what's important to remember. When you read your issue of EOS that comes in the mail every month or whatever it is, and you're hearing about anthropogenic change, this isn't just about the specifics of climate change or scientific disciplines. It's an intellectual revolution, just as profound as what Newton and Darwin and Einstein brought to us. This is a profoundly important revision in how the human animal has been thinking for the past 4 million years. We are active agents of change on the planet today. So perception matters. It's key. Because basically, we don't have a problem of economics, technology, policy, and science. We understand what's going on, and we understand how to deal with climate change. What we have is a problem of understanding in our hearts and minds that climate change is real, that the general public has that problem, that climate change is real, and that we need to do something about it. So because of the point that perception matters, we get out there, we use our voice, our Extreme Ice Survey team, Earth Vision Trust team, as loudly as possible, and that's what you guys are all doing from the standpoint of your own science. And over again, in all the question and answer sessions after the films, as we traveled the world showing the film, there's always people in the room saying, what can I do, what can I do, what can I do? And our answer is always, look into your own heart, use your own skills, use your own capabilities. And the most direct thing, not necessarily the easiest thing, but sometimes the easiest thing you can do, is use your voice. You're all using your voices through the language of science. That's critical, that's important, but it's not just about the science. It's about trying to reshape the world of your family life, your institutional life, your kids' lives, your coworkers, everybody, to acknowledge the fact that climate change is real and to use that information to affect what kind of a car you buy, how you use or waste electricity in your world, how you use or waste heat in your world, et cetera, et cetera. There's so many things, and there's no excuse for not paying attention. We understand what the problem is, and we understand how to deal with it. And it's really not too big. So one last note, I want to come back to Sir Edmund Hillary, the first man, the first of two men to climb Mount Everest back in 1953. And this is it, he says it as succinctly as we need. When you get that sense of despair in your gut about climate change is too big, it isn't, you know? You really don't have to be a fantastic hero. You don't have to be 20 feet tall. You just have to be sufficiently motivated. You wake up, you show up, you pay attention, and you do what needs to be done. Thank you.
That was wonderful. Thank you so much. That's spectacular. And I'm going to sink into this chair. If I don't disappear entirely into this cushy chair, I would like to open this up for questions. And we have a couple of microphones in the back. I understand that if you're also shy about going to a microphone, you're welcome to tweet a question, and that question can make its way to us up here as well. So please feel free to come up to the mics. Let me throw out the first question, which is one of the most dramatic places in the world where we're seeing this effect is probably the hardest place for you to get to, the Arctic Ocean, where the change is completely dramatic. Have you chewed on that? Is there anything you can do to get up there? There's no place you can bolt a camera, right?
Yeah, it's a difficult problem photographically. We had a team on a Norwegian icebreaker at the end of last September during the record summer sea ice minimum. And the problem photographically turned out to be exactly what I thought it was, namely that all sea ice looks the same to a camera. You could see a maximum sea ice period or you could see a minimum sea ice period, and it all is just floating blobs of white. It's incredibly beautiful and dramatic, and you can see lots of polar bears swimming around and standing on the ice or whatever, but how you show change is, I don't think it's accessible to ground level photography. I think satellites are by far and away the best way to look at a changing Arctic Ocean.
Yeah, and there clearly are dramatic images from NSIDC in Boulder has a wonderful website that documents this.
That's
watching the ice melt folks up there, but they are, you know, it really is a dramatic place. I guess the other, let's take a question from the audience here. Please introduce yourself and ask a succinct question.
My name is Janet Herring. I'm the director of the Swiss Federal Institute of Aquatic Science and Technology in Zurich, Switzerland. I have one very short comment and then a question. And the comment is that you said we should ask ourselves what kind of car we would buy. And I would suggest you rephrase that question as to whether we should buy a car at all. But the question is, a few years ago, Kim Stanley Robinson put out a trilogy of science fiction books. The first was called 40 Days of Rain, and he suggested in this future period a substantial geoengineering to reverse global warming. And I just wonder what your thoughts are on geoengineering.
On your first point, unfortunately, in a good bit of the United States, public transportation is basically useless or unavailable. So you're kind of stuck with the car, especially if you live in rough terrain. What's going on?
Geoengineering.
Yes, geoengineering. I'm deeply nervous about geoengineering, It may turn out to be that that's the only salvation, to throw a lot more gunk in the air to act as an umbrella and limit the incoming solar radiation. But boy, if the history of civilization has shown us anything, it's that there's lots of unintended Murphy's Law consequences, and it just gives me the willies. I would much rather that we focus on minimizing the chemicals and particulates we're dumping into the air from those toxic waste products.
Yeah, and I would argue that, in fact, we are already engineering. This is already geoengineering.
It is.
It's an unintentional scale, but a massive scale.
Unplanned.
And I think my point on, or my thought on geoengineering is, in the first place, if you put sulfur particles in the atmosphere, you can cool the planet, but you do absolutely nothing for the oceans in terms of how much carbon dioxide they soak up. And as I say, I went to the Great Barrier Reef and I saw, you know, the oceans are 30% more acidic now than they were a century ago. I mean, it's a huge change, and it's going to increase rapidly. And geoengineering is not going to help that at all. To the extent that it puts away the rest of the problem, it'll probably exacerbate it because it's an excuse to keep burning fossil fuels. What troubles me, though, about the term, I mean, some people object to the term overall as of geoengineering, but I think that one problem with it is people have lumped together not only putting some of these ideas like putting sulfur particles in the atmosphere, but they also include, in geoengineering, some people do, the idea of capturing carbon dioxide from the air and sequestering it. And I think that's actually a very intriguing idea and worthy of pursuit. And some people have been lumping that with geoengineering. There is some pushback against doing that because the fear is that if you perceive that it's easy to take carbon dioxide out of the air, that lessens our push to try to stop the sources of carbon dioxide. I think that's a bit of a red herring, but I think that's partly why the idea of capturing carbon dioxide from air and sequestering it has been labeled as geoengineering, and there's some resistance to that. I think if that technology could evolve, that would be terrific. I mean, if you accept some of the scientific observation that 350 parts per million is a good place to end up with CO2 in the atmosphere, and we're already at 400, it's not going to come out of the air by itself. We are going to have to pull it out of the air. And it's going to be, by the way, much harder than simply pulling it out of the air, because as you pull it out of the air, the carbon dioxide that's been soaked into the oceans will then start coming out of the oceans again, and you'll have to, and that's good for the oceans, but on the other hand, it means that if you're just sort of doing a simple calculation about how much CO2 you have to grab out of the air to bring CO2 levels back to 350 or whatever level you decide you want to stabilize at, it's going to be an even harder project. So it's the issue of pulling CO2 out of the air is an enormous challenge, and it's, you know, decades, even if there's a technology that could be developed to do it. But I actually have a story about this coming up probably later this week, but so it's fresh on my mind. But I think that's, you know, I think that when people are talking about geoengineering, you need to be pretty careful about whether you're talking about affecting the radiative balance of the atmosphere or whether you're talking about other things that are physically affecting the planet. We have another question back here.
Yes, we have a question from our Twitter feed, which is, how can you transition from the issue of rapid glacial loss into a greater discussion of climate change policy responses?
Well, we're already there. The president mentioned it yesterday. It's been mentioned a lot for many years. It's, you know, the key thing to remember, and I did not mention it when I set up the Extreme Ice Survey in the show, is that glaciers are one of the places, are the primary place, really, where you can see and touch and hear and feel climate change in action. So in animating that and making it alive, we've brought climate change as a concept into photographic form. And as we know, recently we're seeing storms and storm impacts and fire impacts as a similar kind of visualization of the problem. But until very recently, we had nothing except the glaciers to go on. So the question of how do we tie the things together? Well, we do everything we can to push the story out there. We, last September, hand-delivered copies of Chasing Ice, the film, to every member of the House and Senate in the United States. Five copies of the film have made their way onto the President Obama's desk over the past 9 months. The film's been shown in the UK House of Commons. It's been shown at the UN. We're doing everything we can to push it into various government-level ministries in Europe. These are all complicated problems, but from where we stand, what we can do with our powers and our voices as visual communicators is to tell the story, put it out there as broadly as possible. Then it's up to the policy people, the economics people, the technology people to come in together with us and push the solutions out there.
Yeah, I think what makes ICE so powerful is that, I mean, we are concerned about catastrophic change and tipping points in the climate system. And what ICE has going for it, for better or worse, is that it has a really clear tipping point, 0 degrees centigrade, right? It goes from solid to liquid at that point.
And as a child, even, you get that. As a two-year-old, you understand that when you hold an ice cube.
So it is, you know, there are obviously much more subtle ones that are harder to come by, to visualize and for people to grab and for us to intellectualize or to bring into our emotions. But that's what makes ICE so powerful is there is this, I mean, it can change really fast. And as you say, glacial speed is not slow, particularly if you're at that tipping point. So.
And the other thing to remember is there is no one magic bullet here. There's something about the human psyche or else our American psyche where we always want to have a single silver bullet solution. Please, dear God, just tell me the one thing we can do. It kind of, you know, Oprah was really good at that on her show. Not that I watched it a lot, but every time somebody came on with a, you know, problem about starving children in Africa, she would always say to her guest speaker, please tell me the one thing we can do to solve the problem of starving children in Africa. Guess what, boys and girls? There is no one single solution to any of the big problems. And no big problem has ever been solved without confronting adversity. Adversity comes with the project. It comes with the picture. That's what we have to be willing to confront. And we also have to be willing to confront the fact that the story is not always happy. A friend of mine who spent a couple years in jail resisting an oil drilling project that the BLM was trying to get through in Utah, he says, you know, look, we've kind of got the naming of this whole problem wrong. We went from global warming because it was inaccurate to climate change because it covered a broader spectrum. But he said, you know, climate change, if you were resistant to the story, to the science, you could say, well, maybe some climate change is good, maybe some is bad. He said we should have more worrisome language. And he also pointed out that if people are fearful, it's not necessarily bad. You know, our basic modern marketing and branding says, well, you don't want people to be upset. It always has to be a happy or entertaining or ironic message. And think about that. Would the human race, being chased by saber-toothed tigers, ever have survived if it was only motivated by happy or entertaining messages? No. The people who survived the saber-toothed tigers were really afraid. And they said, let's get away from the saber-toothed tiger. I think we're in a situation like that now. And it's this point that my friends made has got me to thinking about maybe not being afraid at all anymore of delivering a fearful message. And frankly, I've never given a damn about whether the story was entertaining or not. It was about telling the truth as we saw it, as we experienced it. But I think we all have to consider the possibility that maybe an entire revamping of the naming and messaging about all of this needs to be considered.
Yeah, and one of the terms I hear from time to time is climate disruption, for example, as a way to do it. But I mean, there are presumably going to be winners and losers in climate change. It's not all negative. In fact, it's probably an issue for why Russia, in particular, is not that concerned about climate change because they actually wouldn't mind Siberia being a bit warmer and makes it a little bit harder to get a global consensus on this issue when, in fact, they are seeing positive things for their territory, you know, on top of, obviously, a lot of negative things for global stability and so on. Anyhow, let me take more questions here, please.
Hi, I'm Keely Maxwell, AAAS Fellow at the EPA, and my question has to do with religion. Religious leaders around the globe are increasingly talking about the need to do something about climate change, whether for reducing human suffering or also sort of the commitment to creation care. And this is a necessary audience globally whom we need to engage. So I guess my question for both of you is, what have your experiences engaging with different faith communities been? And how do you think art and science can be used to engage more members of different faith communities with the climate change question?
We have actively been building an alliance with two major American evangelical groups that are in the creation care movement. And they've been extremely passionate and excited about working our materials into their storytelling. And I think it's essential. The people of the future are going to look back at us and realize that we're just as daft as those people were who thought that slavery was necessary. They're going to say, huh, how could you have been missing the facts? How could you have been missing the moral and ethical underpinning of all of this? Sometimes I wonder if they're going to look back at us and think that we were criminals for not acting on this point more quickly. So I think any ethically based, morally based allies for this message need to be brought into our part of the storytelling, and we're doing the best we can with our resources to do that.
And I just agree that's a critical point, because people, the American public, the general public, is not going to sit down and digest the science and read all of the papers and decide what's right or wrong. They turn to thought leaders just the way Congress people turn to thought leaders, and they say, okay, I'm going to, and we all do that, for whatever issues. And so that is critical to make sure the thought leaders throughout society are aware of these issues and have thought them through and understand them and take a position, because that makes much more difference than many other measures you can take. So I think that's a critical point. Thank you for raising it. Over here.
Hi, my name is Laura Peterson. I'm a reporter with GreenWire. My question is, you mentioned climate change is happening, which is so beautifully shown in your images and in the film. In the broader public, how close do you think we are from moving away of the conversation that, yes, climate change is happening, to what are we going to do about it, especially in Congress here in Washington?
Run that by me again. I'm not sure I caught that last part.
Sure. Basically, it seems like part of the conversation is still focused on whether or not climate change is happening. I'm wondering how close you think, broadly speaking, we are to moving past that part of the conversation.
Yeah, I think we are largely past that. The polls are showing that. If you really want some information on how the American public digests this from an opinion standpoint, look up something called Six Americas. It's a study that my friend Tony Lazarowitz at Yale has been leading for many years, analyzing American opinions. The Pew Trust also monitors these things. And we have a solid majority of the American public that thinks climate change is real and that it's human caused, and an even broader majority that says that it's that there is climate change. To make that more clear, 70% plus think that climate change is real. Nearly 60% that think that it's human caused climate change. 60% is a very, very strong majority. And until recent years in Congress, a 58 or 60% majority was sufficient for actually getting policy enacted. Now, in this current era of partisan politics, where there's no center anymore, and it's just warring extremes throwing mud at each other, you don't get action necessarily with a 58 or 60% majority. But basically, the president recognized in his speech yesterday that Congress isn't going to do anything because of that problem of the partisan politics. So he does what he can with executive orders, and I think that's an extremely powerful move. And I think what they did in the administration a year and a half ago to raise the automotive fuel standards for cars being manufactured in the United States, as well as sold in the United States and manufactured elsewhere, that was an incredibly powerful stroke that they're not given enough credit for. But what they're doing right now with the coal-fired power plant emissions and some of the mitigation measures that are being proposed, I think this is all to the good, in spite of the fact that Congress isn't acting. But the other thing that Richard mentioned before that's critical is to recognize that the states are acting. You know, we've got at least 9 states with major climate change legislation and mitigation efforts underway, and many more with modest efforts underway. And my friends who are in the legislative community have said, don't forget that back in the late 60s, early 70s, when all the basic environmental protection laws were enacted, that started at the state level. It didn't start at the federal level. It started at the state level and worked its way up because the companies who had to operate in the national economy said, please, federal government, give us standardized legislation across the country, across the board, so we have a level playing field and we know what we're dealing with. I think we're eventually going to get to that point again.
Let's take a pause from questions. Don't sit down. You all participate, or some of you were invited to participate in a survey at the beginning of this presentation, and I understand the results are in. So let's take a moment and look at them. And the first question is, what is the most negative effect of climate change? And obviously the vast majority of you, or a good majority, said environmental impacts. 35% said intensity of severe weather events and sea level rise. And 9% said risk averse to human health conditions. And let's look at the other results and then chew on them for a moment. Do you agree how effective would substantial cuts to greenhouse gases be? And 85% said somewhat effective, 3% said not at all, and 12% said completely. And I guess this gets to, that for that question, obviously it comes down to the definition of substantial and who's doing the substantial cutting, right? Because I think that we could substantially cut greenhouse gases in this country, and it wouldn't really matter if China doesn't make substantial cuts as well. So, but it is interesting that, I'm guessing that most people went on that somewhat bar because the word substantial is a judgmental word that you apply your own judgment to. But that's interesting. I think that's an interesting result to ponder. What do you take from this?
Well, I drilled in on exactly that same word, too. I think the pollsters need to come up with different language. No, it's perfectly fine language, actually. I'm teasing. But, yeah, I think the substantial and the question of who's doing the cuts is critical. And that's why there's this sort of somewhat ambiguous commentary on the 85%. What does it all mean? How do you slice and dice that somewhat?
And on the pie chart, obviously, these are overlapping issues, so it's not an either or issue here. So people were asked to pick the single biggest one. What do you make of the fact that it's 9% of folks think that the biggest risk is adverse health conditions?
Yeah, that story hasn't been told very well. It really was not significantly on the map 5 or 6 years ago, and it's just been coming out the past few years. And some of the numbers are absolutely staggering. The Chinese came out with a study back about 2 months ago, maybe 3 months ago, that said that in 2010 alone, they think they had 1.2 million premature deaths in China as a consequence of air pollution. That's staggering, because we know that the Chinese government doesn't like to lose face. And if they came out with 1.2 million deaths admitted, it was undoubtedly a lot worse than that. So it's, and there's studies that show premature pulmonary deaths in the United States, in the tens, maybe hundreds of thousands, Europe, and so forth. So it's a big story, and it's really just now gaining traction. And I think over time, you would see that 9% turning into a much bigger number as the story continues to get told. Moving forward with our creative work, the big project I'm thinking about is sort of the next big creative piece, Beyond Ice, will undoubtedly bring that health story into the conversation.
And I think my guess why it's a small percentage is that obviously we can do things to mitigate those. We can run in, if we have air conditioning, you can run into air conditioning and reduce those risks. There are many things that we can do, particularly in an advanced culture society, to do that. Environmental impacts are, you know, the trees can't defend themselves from the pine bark beetle and the balsam woolly adelgid and all the rest of that stuff. So I think that I understand why there's a much bigger slice for that, because they're effects that are much, much harder to mitigate. So more questions, please.
First, a response to your comment just now, Richard. United States, throughout much of its history, has contributed leadership to the world regarding conservation and environmental protection, going all the way back to the National Park concept and on up through the Clean Air Act and Clean Water Act and the environmental. But we've abandoned that leadership. And everybody always says, well, what about China and India? If we're going to have any leverage with these huge developing countries, we've got to reassert that leadership by doing what needs to be done ourselves. So I think that's really important, and I'm so glad about what President Obama said yesterday. But you know, a public policy change is what's needed to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. Now, there are a couple of organizations that you know about, such as 350.org and Citizens Climate Lobby. But if there's that 60% majority in favor of doing something about greenhouse gas emissions that you cite, how do we galvanize that to bring pressure on representatives at every level, municipal, county, state, and national, even international? How do we galvanize that to get the public policy changes that are needed?
Could you introduce yourself, please?
Oh, I'm sorry. George Stone, Milwaukee Area Technical College.
Thank you. Want to take that question?
That's a huge issue of activism, and basically I think the answer is things are already galvanized. It's not just about 350 at the national and international level. In every single place I go, there are grassroots groups that are hammering away at their city councils and their state governments trying to affect climate change. This is not an unnoticed issue. And I think we're in the process of making forward progress. That's the best I can tell you. It never seems like it's enough. It never seems like it's fast enough, but it's happening. The other, to your earlier point, this question of American leadership is an interesting one. Yes, I believe in the fact that there has to be American leadership on this. Yes, we are a thought leader globally. But the reality is that over the past X number of years, I don't know what the number is, 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, something, it's gone from being a world that was substantially led by the United States because of our economic influence and our military influence, to now much more of a multipolar world, and we're having a hard time adjusting to that fact. Obviously, China is a major, major player on the global stage economically, and we have to accept the fact that we don't have the, as I think they call it in the defense industry, the muscular posture that we used to have. We can't afford the muscular posture the way we used to do. We spent a lot of that in the Middle East in the past 10 years. But more importantly, there are very significant players economically and culturally. The Chinese own a lot of our government debt right now, and it's going to be that way more or less indefinitely. So we're in this together, this idea of always being antagonistic to other countries and thinking we have to dominate the world and lead the world. That's a thing of the past. We're in this together, have to work together. And it's not saying it's going to be easy. You can see the way the Russians are playing games with the Snowden situation right now. They're quite eager to kind of poke us in the eye over that and hide Snowden to make us look bad. That's the way it goes. That's geopolitics. But we have to recognize we're in this game together and do the best we can to get everybody moving in the same direction. But one final point is China is moving in this direction. They have created the largest manufacturers of solar panels in the world, the largest manufacturer of wind turbines, and they have the most stringent mileage standards. And they recognize that they've got gigantic public health problems. And this very month, they've been having these big campaigns in some of the major cities to try and get the pollution to be reduced because they realize it's a serious problem to the health and well-being and just general happiness of their population.
Yeah. Let me just say a couple words also in addition to that, which is that, of course, the United States has an obligation, a moral obligation to act in the face of the facts. I think that how much of an example we set, whether people will follow our lead, I'm not so sure about. What I do know is that the Chinese government listens to its scientists, and the scientists in China, as the scientists do around the rest of the world, say this is a big and significant problem. And so this is really where science comes in. You can have cultures around the world that look at things in a very different way, but if they are all looking at the science using, you know, the same tools that we use here and coming to the same conclusions, that's incredibly powerful. And I think that's ultimately what is going to drive global change, is people recognizing that that this is a serious situation, and that everyone has to step up and do something. It's not that, oh, well, you know, it's not simply that we're setting the good example that everyone else is going to follow. I think that's an element of it. But I think that if people are going to react based on the facts. Obviously, I'm not talking about the economics here, which is another entire layer, but that's critical as well, making sure that things happen more or less on even economic footing. Otherwise, I mean, that's the grease you need to do to make the motion happen. But I think fundamentally, everyone agrees that this is a significant issue, and that's there. I think China is reacting as much to that as it is more to that than the fact that the United States and Europe are, you know, are trying to set an example, quote unquote. Another question.
Bob Magenson, University of Michigan. These are very powerful pictures you've shown us. And the question I have has partly been answered since the poll was shown, but there is a very, very large human story behind these pictures already, because we know that there are people who live in these areas. And I'm thinking, in this country, for example, in Alaska, we already have people who are being hammered by climate change, who's living conditions are being modified by it to the extent that they just cannot live the existence that they have in the past. I have relatives who live on a couple of reservations in the Dakotas who really believe that in the marginal places that they live, they're already seeing effects that are adversely affecting them. Now, we still want to talk about climate change as whether it's going to be something that affects us in the distant future or the near future, but we still use the language of the future to say this, and there are people who are already being harmed by this. How do we get our representatives to understand that? Because some of these people are their constituents. The same argument applies to Canada, where there's a certain political system in place right at the moment, you know, that is not very favorable to the recognition of the impacts of climate change, but there are people there who are already discovering they cannot live the way that they have been living, or perhaps cannot even live at all under the current situation, not just some situational theoretically impact us 50 years or 10 years in the future.
Yeah, I think the idea that climate change is real and happening right now has gotten out there. I agree with you about the human impacts. You know, in terms of our creativity in our filmmaking, you have to keep your stories concise. You know, you can't do everything. There's 20 stories that could be done right now, and a few people are doing them. But the reality is that if you're looking for a story arc in a given project, you've got to keep it fairly clean and straightforward. When we work in Patagonia next year, we've got a couple human stories on the grounds that will be part of that storytelling. And so we will get into that more. And originally, when we went up to Greenland, we thought we would be digging into the Inuit story. And it just turned out to be sort of, I don't know, tangential to our bigger revelation that we found with the glaciers. And it was also a story that, you know, every time a BBC crew or an NBC crew or an NHK crew or whatever went up there, the story was getting told, oh, okay, you local fishermen, how does climate change affect you? And the guys would stand there in their polar bear skin pants and tell the story. There was nothing new in it, whereas what we wanted to pursue was some kind of a creative frontier. I will say that National Geographic has done a lot of stories over the past half a dozen years about human impacts of anthropogenic change. And it's a story that's actually easy to tell as sort of a what is referred to in the TV business as the voice of God narrative. There's sort of that godly voice that's telling you what to think about the story. It's a much harder story to tell in sort of cinema verite, you know, down on the ground, let's kind of live with this guy for the next 2 years and see what climate change brings to him. It's an expensive story. It's very expensive to do this stuff. So I think that the, you know, how climate change is happening right now, touching people right now, is vitally important to do. And it needs about a $10 million check and five film crews to do it adequately. And I haven't seen any $10 million checks coming from anywhere right now.
Mm-hmm. I would just add that that there's an assumption that there should be, that status quo today is going to be locked in, and any deviation from that is a problem. That cuts both ways, because I think when you ask who are the congresspeople who are most find action most objectionable, they may be defending the livelihoods of coal miners. Or, I mean, there are lots of people whose lives today depend upon fossil fuels. And those people are going to have to, you know, we as a society have to make sure that they find different ways to make a living and so on. But we are talking about disruptions in changing, reacting to climate change. We are talking about disruptions of people's lives. And some of the resistance to this is people, even though the lives may be better than the people have today who are coal miners, that's what they know, and that's what their congresspeople are defending for them. So I mean, think a little deeply about whether we really want to maintain status quo. I don't think we can maintain status quo, because that's leading in a direction that is troubling. So at any rate, it's a subtle and interesting question you raise.
You know, sort of related to this, I gave a couple of presentations in Iowa in April at the couple big university towns. And I discovered, because of people who were in the audiences and officials at these universities coming up to me, that Iowa is one of the national leaders in renewable energy. A major leader, like not in like 5% or 6%, but like a quarter of the energy, the electrical energy in most of the big cities in Iowa is coming from wind. And if that story were told nationally, it would be inspiring. You know, you don't think of Iowa as being a California-like cutting-edge place. It's a good heartland, solid place, lots of corn farms and hog farms and so on. And yet here they're saying, hey, there's a better way to do this. We haven't run out of oil and coal yet, but there's a better way to do this. And it's creating new jobs in our economy. That's a fantastic story. And as far as I know, it hasn't been told enough. Would you go there next week?
I'll check my calendar. Anyway, thank you all very much. You've been an attentive audience, and I do appreciate it. I guess we are now segueing into a break that will be about till 10:30, I think, is the next session. But anyway, thank you all for your attention.